So the last time I was in a relationship was 2019. That's the last time I was in a romantic relationship. And this woman used to accuse me of being boring. Rightfully so. I'm a stickler to norms that I'm familiar with, all right, for lack of a better word. So that if I find a restaurant I like, I will go there, ask my mashed potatoes, my mushrooms, and some chicken breast, and then I'll eat that all the time. So she used to accuse me of being boring. And so she said to me, let's try different things. I mean, I appreciate the restaurant treats, but we sit in the same corner and it's all boring. And so to become a better boyfriend, I decided to devise different things to do. So we started going for walks. And one of my choice places to go for walks was in Karura Forest. If you live in Nairobi, you would be conversant with that. And so this one time we were walking and holding hands and doing what lovers would do best. We were observing. I love to watch people. I people watch a lot. Even to date, I go to restaurants, sit down, ask for coffee, and then I start staring. I don't stare, sorry. I look at people and really read their body language and look at their communication skills and try to make out the sort of relationship they have and so on and so forth. So this one time, my girlfriend then and I are walking in Karura, and she said to me, she said, you look at how these guys ahead of us look so happy. They look very happy. I mean, they're holding hands and the chick was giggling and the man was beaming with a smile from ear to ear. You know, something like he was so excited, right? And so she asked me, why is it you think that people move from these to the divorce courts? And it was a very interesting question. And that's what I want us to talk about today. A very good evening to you. If it's your first time here, thank you so much for choosing to hang out with me. My name is Eric. This is Eric Stories, where every evening around this time, 7-ish, you and I sit down together and exchange ideas around issues of everyday life. I value all of your perspective and feedback. Don't hold it back. Write to me. My DM is open. Comment section are open. If you haven't already, please subscribe to the channel on YouTube. I'm also on Instagram and Twitter. And yes, I'm well rested. And Karibu, or welcome. Somebody put me to task. Was it yesterday? This lady, friend of the series, she wrote to me sometime last week. You and I had a conversation around dealing with breakup. You remember that? I think it was on Thursday. And she said to me, Eric, this is so simplistic. I'm not taking these lying down. I don't think relationships are this light a matter. And I think there should be a more rigorous way to go about this than what you've shared. And I heard her. I mean, I hear where she's coming from. I'm trying to divorce myself from my yesteryear self. I used to be so nonchalant about boyfriend girlfriend relationship. I paid them very little mind. In fact, it's pity as how I used to date. I was just like, ah, you know, the way you I don't hold them. I never used to hold them in high regard, which is wrong because from them comes out, spousal relationships and marriages and so on and so forth. So I'm changing that. And maybe that's why sometimes, if you listen to me, I sound so withdrawn around boyfriend girlfriend relationships. I'm changing. So I wanted to have a quick chat about moving forward when your husband or wife leaves. Because this is serious, right? It is very serious. You're married to these people and they leave. They leave. They come one evening and say, you know what? I am leaving this marriage. All right? So, how can you attain some level of comfort or healing after your husband or wife leaves you for another man or woman? I think that's a more serious relationship. All right? If it's happened to you, I'm looking forward to hearing what you've done or what you're doing. But I've just been thinking around these things. I think sometimes a lot around issues of everyday life, even as it pertains my own, and sometimes I wonder because life is not in a straight line as we agree all the time. And then stability, as I keep sharing, is a mirage. It doesn't exist. You're married today, then you're divorced tomorrow. You get pregnant today and then you get a miscarriage tomorrow, God forbid. You are young today, then you're old tomorrow. And you do a wedding today, and then the next thing you know, a year or sometimes months in, you're in the divorce courts. So stability is a mirage, it doesn't exist. So I thought we'll have a conversation around this. And of course, I don't have this experience. I've never been married, but I've read and I talk to people who have and who've left each other. And I want to share about some of the things I think are important for somebody to pick up. So one of the things I think is very, very, very key is to admit the hurt, all right? That you have been betrayed, you've been lied to, and your heart has been broken, and that your marital status won't be the same again is something worth admitting. Admit it. Admit the heartache. Don't smile through it. Don't giggle. Don't bastardize it. Don't say, ni hali ya maisha, this is life, c'est la vie, ha ha ha, cheers. No, your heart. Admit it. When something dies, though, don't die with it. I think oftentimes we are taken to really grieving to points where segments of our lives also die. And I think a way to live on after something dies, like a wife comes home and says, I'm leaving you, I'm pregnant with somebody else, is to try to realize that their leaving is not a direct reflection on you. I mean, the more you get that, the better. People leave for myriad of reasons, you know. Women and men cheat for vast variety of reasons. Seldom anything to do with us. First of all, they've cheated because they want to. So it's important to realize that. I think a lot of us organize that, supposing you're maybe slightly richer or slimmer or maybe more lighter, they would have stayed, but not. All right? Many of the reasons people cheat has got really nothing to do with the person who has, you know, been left. You who's been left, nothing to do with you at all. I think it's important to remind yourself that it's not that you are not good enough or that the person they've gone to be with is better than you, all right? If you haven't already, that wonderful book you should read, I think a lot of ladies have, Eat, Pray, Love. Elizabeth Gilbert gives a phenomenal story in there about how she just got tired of being married, and while her husband was sleeping in the bedroom, she'd go to the bathroom crying and wondering why she ended up in such a situation. She was tired. She didn't want to be married, at least to him, all right? So sometimes people just don't want to be married, and it's got nothing to do with what you've done. It's got nothing to do with what you do not have or what you have, all right? They've just elected not to be married for, again, myriad of reasons, some of which will stay unbeknownst to you, sometimes even unbeknownst to them. Sometimes, like Elizabeth Gilbert in Eat, Pray, Love, you just don't have the want to. So it's important. It's important to give yourself a break and not condemn yourself, right? And now, then they're leaving, what do you do? I think it's important to find a more fulfilling life by mapping out a life of your own making. You know, it's amazing that marriage once defined you and your kids together was something you really always look forward to, but they've left. That is the reality. So you want to read, maybe for pleasure, or reevaluate career goals, maybe. And traveling, Elizabeth, again, Gilbert in the book talks a lot about how she traveled, I think, Indonesia, India, and was it Italy, you know? So travel. All this can show you a more fulfilling life by opening different doors that you were blind to, all right? So just find a way to map out a more fulfilling life. It's difficult. I get it. It's sad and hard and what are people going to say? In fact, somebody was saying once that this woman was left, or this man was left, or woman, or either, or it happened to the human family, and then they just kept calling themselves Mrs. So-and-so and didn't want anybody to know that the marriage has ended. All right? So maybe find things that you can fill in the gap of that person having left. All right? Another thing I've learned, maybe not in a marriage setting, but you want to embrace your anger. I remember when my mother died, I read so many books about trying to deal with that feeling of being upset. And one thing stood out for me from a book I read, I can't remember which. This person was saying that a way to be wholesome is to feel whichever feelings of emotions you might be going through until you don't feel them anymore. And I thought that was great. And I did that and it works magic. So if you're feeling rage and anger and utter despair, feel it until you don't want to feel it anymore, until the feeling of sadness has gone away, and it's possible. So embrace the anger, allow yourself permission to express every single emotion that bubbles up. right? Including complete rage or anger, completely grieve until you don't feel like grieving anymore. It's possible. I remember doing that. I was so angry when my mother passed on. And I was just like, when I'm angry, I'm angry, I'm angry, I'm angry. All right? C.S. Lewis, another phenomenal book I've read. Small piece of writing, but really profound. A grief observed when he was grieving the death of his wife. They got married when she was lying on an ICU bed. A sad story, but very important. He writes a whole bunch of things in there that can help you. So go check it out. Don't compare yourself to the other woman or man. We do this often. Somebody leaves you and you start thinking, is it because they are taller? Is it because they are his tribe or her tribe? You know, these people have strengths you do not have. They also have weaknesses you do not have. Similarly, you have strengths they do not have, and you have weaknesses they do not have. So it's an exercise in futility and quite pointless to compare. All right? It's a complete waste of energy and time. Don't compare yourself with these other people. It's not because of them oftentimes that these people leave. These people left because they wanted to leave. Okay? Another thing I think is useful to do is to try and spend time with people who've gone through this thing you're going through at the present moment. I was once hanging out with a friend of mine, and then these older ladies came, and then I later realized that one of the older ladies was a wife to some politician, at least the first wife, and went on about how this politician left her for this other woman. And you know, people are asking, how did you go through that? It must have been really, really hard. And she was very graceful, you know, so she went on explaining what she did. So spend quality time with women or men who've survived their spouse walking out on them. All right? In life, the beauty of life is that somebody has experienced what it is you think is so heinous. So you can have a conversation with them. If they've survived the end of their marriage in especially a healthy way, all right, and they are stronger, happier, healthier, the better. Spend time with them and ask questions and learn the ropes from them. It will do you some good. You want to connect with people who've been where you are and have some level of understanding about what it is you're going through. Okay? Then soak up all their courage and wisdom. Ask questions so that you don't think you're the first person to have undergone this thing that is obviously very bad that is happening to you. And then finally, you want to let go of the hopes and the dreams of your marriage. I know you had all these elaborate dreams, how you're going to grow old together, but that's just not the reality now, all right? Divorce yourself from the victim mentality. You're a survivor, right? Don't fight the reality. She has left you. He has left you. That is the reality. Accept and face the truth and surrender to what is, instead of wallowing and wishing onto a life that will never be, the life you had envisioned in your mind. All right? So I'm just thinking, hopefully this is a more wholesome way to deal with it, more than my initial, you know, think about the worst things they've done. That also has its place. But I think in the nitty-gritty of what to do, I think these would be useful. Did your partner ever leave? How are you handling it? Or how did you handle it? Please let me know. All right? So that even in thinking of the good, you have the bad at the back of your mind. Supposing the bad happens, you're not ill-equipped. Good evening. My name is Eric. Have a lovely night.